thanks a lot. It is so wonderful to be back here. It's my third year in a row, actually, so far. Every instance of the Things Conference has been present. And when I was first dealing with Johan and Wienke back in 2015, the idea was just to build a community. And what we see now here, you in the room, but also all the stands here behind, is that we've not just built a community around LoRaWAN and LPWAN, we've built a real ecosystem. And that is fantastic. We've gone from a couple of guys sitting in a kitchen table at the Rockstars trying to build small devices and just plugging wires in breadboards to actually shipping hundreds of thousands of units and growing that to an ecosystem of millions of devices shipped just by this ecosystem, which is absolutely fantastic. So I think I'm most known within the LoRaWAN community as one of the persons, together with Nicola and Johan, to bring firmware updates to LoRaWAN. So that's a process that we've been doing over the last 3 years, basically. That process is now done, and I figured, let's do something else. So we're kind of looking forward, and my next move was very much motivated by what we've learned from interacting with the ecosystem over the past years. So we started a new company, Edge Impulse, doing that together with Zach Shelby, who was presenting here yesterday. We're a small team, just 4 people. But our mission and where we come from is very much determined by our interactions with LPWAN. If you look at devices that are currently on the market, we've seen tremendous growth in the quality of things. When I first bought LoRaWAN devices, back when I was in Telenor in 2015, the only thing I could actually get were very simple motion sensors. Everything else was available, but when you actually tried to buy it, no one would actually deliver it. They only had ABP. All the keys that I got were literally just in an Excel file that I had to like import into our own network server at the time. And hardware quality was pretty bad as well. These days, this is the type of sensor that you can buy now on the market. And if you look at the hardware specifications, it's absolutely fantastic. This device, Sushi sensor, has a vibration sensor that up to 1,000 vibrations a second, can measure that. It's almost like a microphone. It has a really accurate temperature sensor. If you ever played with building your own IoT device, you realize that temperature sensors are very imprecise, maybe a 2-degree range. This one is much better. It has NFC for easy configuration and onboarding to the network. And it's even water and explosion proof. Absolutely brilliant. And it comes with a processor that's capable of running over 20 million instructions per second. And this is cool. There's many more devices. If you look at the big wall, devices with these kind of capabilities and this kind of engineering quality are becoming ubiquitous within the ecosystem, and that is very great. But what are we doing with these devices? Like, barely anything. If we're looking at this device, like in default configuration mode, once an hour it sends the average motion from the accelerometer. It sends the peak motion and then the current temperature. All those other readings that we potentially could take from this device, we just throw away. And the reason that we do that is because, well, we need this 2, 3, or 10 years of battery life out of these devices, and driving the radio is really expensive. If you look at how long a LoRaWAN device will run off a battery, it's almost completely dominated by how often you transmit to the network. So we're doing that only once an hour. That is the only way we can achieve this battery life. But it's such a waste of all the resources. So what we see as Edge Impulse and what we want to change is this. 99% of sensor data is currently discarded due to cost, bandwidth, or power constraints. These bandwidth and power constraints are very, very real with LoRaWAN. And the physical world, as all the device makers that are sitting in this room know, has lots and lots of data. The accelerometer that was in the sushi sensor can do measurements at 1,000 times a second on 3 different axes. That's a lot of data that can be generated. Swim.ai, a startup that we used to work with in ARM, showed this very nicely. So they, in the city of Palo Alto in California, they put sensors on all the streetlights. For example, to measure the flow of cars through the city. And the raw sensor data of all those, the raw sensor data of all these devices generate more data than all of Twitter combined. And that is just for a single municipality. So sending that all over to a central location and doing the processing there is not just impractical, it's actually impossible. So for us, we think that on-device intelligence, so rather than getting all the raw data, shipping it off somewhere, which might be very impractical or even impossible, we need to do on-device intelligence. We need to process this data in here. So the device itself should not think about raw sensor streams. It should actually answer questions. It should tell me that the vibration pattern that we heard actually could lead to a fault state in a week. That is interesting information that I want to get, not this raw sensor stream. I might want to say that, well, the temperature that I'm currently reading over the last hour varied in a way that I've never seen before. So maybe something is going wrong, and I want a technician to come and take a look. Or actually comparing it to other devices that you have in your farm. Maybe this machine oscillates differently than all the other machines. That might be an interesting use case. So rather than think of raw sensor streams, we just want to send this conclusion over. And the benefit here is, one, vastly less data, because the only thing I need to send over is a single byte indicating the code, either it's okay or it's wrong or this is the reason. And I also don't have to send that often, saving on battery life. Because if I know that my algorithm on my device knows exactly when a fault state is going to trigger, I don't need to send every hour. I only need to send when I know that something is going wrong. That's the moment that I want to interact with it. So let's fix it. Like Wienke and Johan looked at the state of LPWAN and IoT communication 5 years ago, and they figured, well, this is terrible, but the technology is great. Let's build a community around it. That's something that we are trying to do here with Edge Impulse. Let's fix this. So how can we go from very capable devices doing very dumb things to very capable devices doing very smart things? Well, machine learning is a very obvious choice because it handles the three cases that I see that we want to handle in embedded devices or IoT devices. Very often the problems that we actually try to answer, if you just look at the business side of it, it's either classification, I want to know what is happening, it's anomaly detection, is the current behavior that I'm seeing out of the ordinary or is this normal, or forecasting, with my current view of the world, what do I think is going to happen? The problem with machine learning, and this is also my take 3 years ago, is that we associate machine learning with really big data centers full of computers crunching numbers. You've seen the AlphaGo documentary. Google actually made a custom piece of silicon, the TPU, and deployed 5,000 of these to actually do the training to learn Go. Unfortunately, I don't have the money to develop a custom processor, let alone 5,000 of them. So this is not applicable to us. Also, if you deploy a sensor in the field at a farm somewhere, and then you say, well, you also need to deploy this data center next to your farm, the business case is not as strong. So how can we leverage this and actually put some intelligence on device? So the picture that you see here is actually an analog computer built in 1963. And it's made out of matchboxes. And this computer learns how to play tic-tac-toe without telling it about any of the rules of tic-tac-toe. And it does that by constantly rebalancing itself while it's playing the game. It's self-learning. Now, how it works is that for every tic-tac-toe state that you have here, like the four here, there's a matchbox that matches this state. Now, at the beginning, in that matchbox, we color code all the possibilities, all the possible moves that we can make. So in this case, on this board, there's five different moves that we can make. We can either place our X on the green, the blue, the purple, the red, or the blue dot. So for every potential possibility where we can make a move, we take two marbles, and we place them in that Lucifer box. Now when you encounter this state and you want to play, you pick at random. You pick one of these marbles out of there, and you leave the box open. And this is the move that you're going to make. So in this case, we place our X here. And then depending on the outcome of the game, so we leave all the boxes open until the end of the game, we either, if we lose, we remove the marble. If we draw, we put one back. But if we win, we put three back. So we're rebalancing the content of the matchbox while playing. So in this case, this is a losing move, because the other player can put their O there, we lose and we remove the marble forever. Now the next time that we encounter this exact same state, at random we pick one of those 9 remaining marbles again, in this case the blue one, we place it here, and this is a winning move. It's great, so instead of, we put the 1 marble back, we put 2 additional marbles in there. Now what you see here is that we've gone, by playing this state twice, we've gone from a chance of 2 out of 10 that we make a winning move to 4 out of 13, which is great. We're slowly rebalancing the state of the game to ensure that we are going to pick winning moves. And this analog computer, after training it for about 600 games, actually becomes relatively good at a game of tic-tac-toe. We didn't tell anything about what this game is or even what the objective of the game is, and it can still learn. Now we can also see that training this is really expensive. If I start with an empty computer and I want to train this whole thing up, it's going to take a very long time. There's hundreds of different states, I think over 600 different states. And I need to encounter every state multiple times before I finally get like a good balancing out. So training of this takes incredibly long. But if I've already done that work and I give you the computer and I say, okay, well, play against this computer, the only thing you need to do is open a box, pick a marble at random, and play that move, and on. So for you, the only thing you need to do, you don't need to do rebalancing, you just open the box, pick a random marble, and play the game against it. So classification, in this case, is very simple and very doable, and that is something we can actually do on these devices. So when I'm talking about adding intelligence to your LoRaWAN device, and I'm talking about machine learning for these devices, I'm not talking about training your models here. Training just classification. So this enables some really amazing new use cases that we couldn't do before. One thing I'm very excited about is sensor fusion. Right now, it's very easy to take a single sensor, an accelerometer, and do some basic analysis. Is there lots of movement going on? But what if I can actually combine 2 sensors at the same time in 1 machine learning model? It means that I can start detecting new events that I've never seen before. It might be very hard to quantize. If I, as a human, try to detect whether a door is open, I'm not just using my eyes, I might also be using sound or airflow that I currently feel. And combining that in a sensor that can detect these kind of things will enable lots and lots of interesting new use cases. So the guys at Gearat made the super sensor, which combines data from 10 different sensors back in 2016. To detect all kinds of household activities. So super interesting. Another one that actually, I was talking with Jaco from Metaplan yesterday, is one where in a factory you have pipes, if pipes start vibrating more violently, it increases the chance that they actually break. Something bad might happen. So putting a sensor in there, just listening to what the pipe is doing and alerting if something changes, might actually help with reducing the fault states in a factory line. And this is the first machine learning use case that I ever built, which was in Arusha in Tanzania, where we put a sensor on a cow and tried to distinguish or try to measure when a cow was acting abnormally, with the goal of trying to determine when a cow was fertile, so they could inject sperm samples into the cow, or to determine when the cow would be getting sick. And this is especially here in Tanzania, the dairy farm is very important because a sperm sample costs between $2 and $4, and actually having a sick cow might be even more expensive, which is a really big case for these people here in third world countries. So I'm very excited about that. So let's go to a practical use case here. So we are going to build a small machine learning model and then actually demo this. So I'm not allowed to speak at a Things conference unless I use a photo of both Wienke and Johan in my talk. That's a deal I made with them. So we're gonna look at what would be required to build a sheep activity tracker. So the idea here is that we have a sensor. It's mounted on the sheep. It has a vibration sensor, an accelerometer on board. And we want to know, based on the vibration pattern, if the sheep is standing, walking, or doing other sheep-related activities. Now, to do that, we first need data, and actually quite a lot of data. So this is kind of a raw data stream. It was captured by Dan, one of our engineers, of a couple of variations of sheep activities. Now you can see this is lots and lots of raw data again. So this is not something that I want to offload over LoRaWAN. This is raw data. So the way that we capture this is that we have a flash chip sitting on device. We store the data in there. And then after we've sampled and labeled, we can either offload this over Wi-Fi or we use a serial cable to get the data off. And to build the classifier that we have today, we captured around 11 minutes of data. So not that much, actually, over four different classes. Now, with machine learning, data is key. Data is king. So where possible, always capture as much data as possible. For a customer use case, even for a first trial, we captured 72 hours of training data just to interact with that, because you want to capture all the variations of a model. So we did the training, actually, on this development board made by ST Microelectronics. So this is the official development board of Edge Impulse as well. So if you, after this talk, you're really excited about machine learning and you want to build a machine learning model that's going to power your LoRaWAN device, pick this board up. The link is on our website. It costs about $50. And to add LoRa, just plug in a shield and you're done with it. Then after capturing raw data, we actually need to extract some features. We want to extract some features. So in my experience, this is something that's overlooked a lot by machine learning experts. We've been doing signal processing and doing some basic device intelligence on devices already for the last 30 years. We just called it digital signal processing. If I'm looking at raw accelerometer data, I don't just want to look at these like 2 seconds of accelerometer data, which is kind of the interval that we use to train the sheep tracker, that is at 100 hertz. That's 600 different data points. That's a lot, and it's very noisy. Accelerometer data is very noisy. So we use standard signal processing tricks to reduce the dimensionality of this. So what we do is we do a fast Fourier transform and look at the frequency peaks. We look at a spectral analysis of the signal. So we compress the 600 data points that we capture initially down to 33 features. And we can actually plot this very nicely in our software. So this is a 3D overview of all my training data, and I can already start separating the four different classes that I've trained. If we're doing audio data, we do something very similar. Out of the 32,000 data points, or 16,000 data points times 2 bytes, we reduce this to about 600 data points. So we already make this a lot smaller. It also means that our machine learning models are much, much more efficient. And after that, we train two models. So for the classification, we use a neural network, a very small neural network. And neural networks are very great at actually classifying something. I give you a signal, you tell me it's either A, B, C, or D. What neural networks are very bad at, unfortunately, is dealing with data that I've never seen before. So if I train this data on walking and running and standing still, but then it is vividly like shake it and I jump around at the same time, the neural network is not going to say, oh, I don't know. There's nothing like that in the neural network. So we also leverage, in this case, for this demo, we leverage an anomaly detection block. So a very simple clustering of data. And then we compare new data to the known clusters. And if that's within a cluster, it means there's data that looks like stuff that we've seen before. So we trust the neural network. And if it's unlike any of the data we've seen before, we don't trust it. We might send it back. And this is because we reduce the feature space so much, we only have 33 data points at this point, we can actually send this over an uplink back to the network and say, well, I saw some data, I'm not sure what it is. Maybe someone, a data engineer, can look at it. And that's totally possible over LoRaWAN. And then for model to device, so we need to run this back on a device. So after training, all the training happens in the cloud or on a computer, but then we need to put it back on the device and actually run this on an embedded system. So we can take our signal processing code on neural network and an anomaly detection, and then we kind of compile it into C++ code, highly optimized. So if your processor has vector extensions, then we can leverage those vector extensions while we're doing our signal processing. And if your processor has a floating point unit, we can actually leverage the floating point unit to do it, et cetera. So after we have the C++ file, we compile it into our firmware. And that is the thing that we then run and we use with our LoRa network to actually do the classification. So how this works, we look at 2 seconds of data at the same time. So we sample for 4 seconds, then we look at the 2 second windows in between, we classify that, and then the results, that is something we send over LoRa back to the Things Industries, so the, to the V3 stack. So think it's now time for a demo. And for that, we actually brought a very special guest. And the guest is, oh wait, sorry, one more slide. I'm getting lost in my own enthusiasm. So the device actually that it's all running at, the SD board, is a very typical IoT device. The processor on here is used in lots of products. So this is an 80 megahertz Cortex M4 with a floating point unit, with 128 kilobytes of RAM, and that runs the full LoRa stack, runs our real-time operating system and our inferencing code, with an SX1276 LoRa radio to actually send data to the network. And we can do this in real time, even on hardware that is this slow. So to do 1 second of activity data to analyze that, so that it runs the full signal processing pipeline, the neural network, and our anomaly detection code, we need 8 milliseconds, which is super awesome. This is stuff that you can actually do in real time, better than real time. So I'm very, very excited about that. So now I think it's going to be absolutely fantastic because I don't want to just talk. I actually want to show you what we've built and show you that this machine learning model actually works. So for that, I want to welcome the sheep.
Shake that.
All right. Okay. So we're connected to the V3 stack right now. We the sheep has a nice little device sitting here with accelerometer. So sheep, stand still. Okay. Let's first test if it works. Can you like walk a circle on stage here? All right. Walking. Yeah. You can stop now. Right, so we need to do a couple seconds inferencing, so there's a bit of delay. Plus, we also are subject to the implementations here. All right, so this is a very, very basic use case, just standing and walking. You know, we need to do something more interesting. So could I get the music back on?
Shake that.
Okay, Sheep, could you do some jumping jacks, maybe? All right, that's good. Sheep, could you do some push-ups for me? In the cup, hard rock, looking for your girl. There we go. Good. Yeah, stand back up. Now, of course, after all this activity, the sheep deserves, you know, like a nice little beer. More beer. Woo! Now, Sheep, why is this relevant for the Things Network?
So this is really relevant for TTM because it's... Thank you. Always happy to help Jan out with his demos. This is a really good combination, machine learning on the edge and LPWAN, because in LPWAN, the biggest constraint is the amount of data that you can send. So when we have existing IoT deployments with a Wi-Fi, for example, and we say, okay, can you replace it with LoRa? The answer is very often no, because we have all this data that we need to gather. And so this actually changes that and brings machine learning to the edge, which makes it more accessible to use less bandwidth, like LoRa, but also makes it much cheaper to process in the cloud. And having LPWAN accessible for edge impulse is also really good because that makes it easier for you guys also because you don't have the connectivity issue.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, for me already, like while we're building this model, I think the combination of having edge impulse for building your machine learning model and then having the Things Network to actually deploy this is really powerful. We had our new engineer basically come on board without any knowledge about neither our platform nor about the Things Network. And we managed to build a demo, capture all the data, and then actually do the inferencing on the new TTI V3 stack in 2 days, which is wonderful. This is a really, really fantastic combination. So thanks, Cheap. So I want to do a small recap. I really hope you enjoyed the conference and the 25 minutes and the fantastic demonstration by Johan. Machine learning, the hype is real. Like, we are working in this field for the last year. Machine learning is not just something you can run in that can be run by big cloud players with really big data centers. It is something that can actually add value to your product. It is here. You can actually build your own models, validate them. You can do it today. My strong belief is that the 2020s, machine learning will be the most important developments that we're going to see as developers. I think that if you look 10 years ago, you wanted to do long-range communication out of a device on a battery, basically impossible. But we all, as a community around LPWAN, have made that possible. It's now just a tool in your toolbox. I can go to a vendor, just get a module, put it on my device, and bam, it works. That is fantastic, and I think that is going to happen with ML as well. In 10 years from now, machine learning will be in the toolbox of every developer, and it will just be another tool you use. It's not magic, just like, you know, LoRaWAN is not magic. Maybe the first time you hear about it, it's fantastic, 10 kilometers of range, but we know that it's very hard to actually get from prototype to all the way production. But it's a tool in the toolbox of every developer now. As well, I think that machine learning and LoRaWAN are an absolute perfect fit. LoRaWAN gives you communication everywhere, but at constraints, bandwidth and power constraints. And putting intelligence on your device means that you, as a device maker, as a solutions provider, can move up to higher value use cases. There's a lot more interesting data we can do, so perfect fit. So the thing that I want to do is, if you're interested in using the remaining 99% of your data, don't wait, start today. It's a new decade. This is a decade of ML. So if you want to do that, head over to edgeimpulse.com. It's our new software, which makes it really easy to build vibration, audio, or any other signals, machine learning networks, and start using that today. Sign up now. And thanks a lot again.
Thanks, Jan. I think we have time for one or two questions. Yes, over here. Oh, it's you again. Hello.
Hello. So, use the 99% of your microprocessor. And what about the power? I mean, the processor is sleeping to save power. Now you wake up the processor, what happens?
Yeah, so it's still very important that you sleep while you're doing this. But instead of waking up every hour, sampling some data and then sending it over LoRa, wake up every hour, wake up every half hour, sample some data, run it through the classifier, see if it's interesting or not, and only then send data over. So don't have the CPU over all the time. But if you look at like how much power it costs and what the power budget constraints are of just driving the radio, you can do a lot of inferencing on it. If we do, one of the examples that Arm gave is that we can do image classification every 5 seconds, and run that actually on a full coin cell, as long as you go to sleep in between. Now try running a LoRaWAN device on a coin cell and see how much actually transmissions you can do. So by saving a couple of transmissions, we can actually do a lot of machine learning on these type of devices.
I see one more question here. Hello.
This is actually a question for the sheep. Is that a...
Oh, sheep.
sorry, I'm only kidding. Is there an argument that says, actually, it is a question for you, 100%, just in terms of if we do develop those machine language algorithms, that we get into that, let's share them. If we optimize them for those processors, we develop a community around just being open and sharing them. I think that would be the way to go because... I mean, if we want to build that machine learning, they have to be super optimized. So why just everybody doing their own different thing? I think it would be a great idea to get there.
Yeah, I completely agree on that. Like, I come from an open source background. I come from a community building background. I've done work on Mozilla, Cloud9, lots of work with the Things Network, with Arm and Embed. Data wants to be free. And data for machine learning purposes on IoT devices is exactly the same. So we're going to do everything in our power to make sure that every developer can just sign up, build these models, share their knowledge with the community, so we can actually, as a community, start leveraging this. And that really excites me.
Okay, thank you. Well, the answer for the sheep is just bah.
It is fine.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Warm applause, Jongboom and Sheep Stocking.